Hey guys, this is Mike Chen. Couple of interesting stories this week, and they're both about NASA. First of all, NASA found a massive 75,000 mile wide hole, and the hole is in the sun. So take a look, here it is, and here is the size of Earth. So if that sunspot was a sinkhole and the Earth was a car, it would fall right in. Also, like Screech naming his pimples, this colossal sunset is so big that NASA even gave it a name, AR2665. Now, the problem with this giant sunspot is that it's capable of producing solar flares that could cause radio blackouts here on Earth. And this could mean potential radiation storms, the disabling of our communication satellites, our GPS, and even electricity shortages in some areas. According to NASA, a new sunspot group has rotated into view and seems to be growing rather quickly. Such sunspots are a common occurrence on the sun, but are less frequent as we head toward solar minimum, which is the period of low solar activity during its regular approximately 11-year cycle. This sunspot is the first to appear after the sun was spotless for 2 days, and it is the only sunspot group at this moment. Like freckles on the face of the sun, they appear to be small features, but size is relative. The dark core of the sunspot is actually larger than Earth. Now, if you don't know what sunspots are, they're basically the cooler areas on the sun, and they are caused by interactions with the sun's magnetic field. So the more intense the magnetic activities, the more likely sunspots tend to appear. And here's the problem. When all that energy is released, solar flares and storms erupt, which are essentially massive solar EMPs. And a really powerful one could even send us back to the Dark Ages. In fact, on July 12th, 2002, you know, the year the world was supposed to end, Earth had a really, really close, a near miss with a giant solar flare, or coronal mass ejection, CME. And this was a product of the most powerful storm on the sun in over 150 years. And the reason you didn't know was because, well, no one told us. So I guess we just kind of all blissfully slept through that one. And the thing is, if we would have received a direct hit from that one, it could have knocked out all power on Earth for not just hours or days, but years. Now imagine that 2-hour blackout you experienced. I mean, that was already pretty rough, right? With no internet, no iPhone. But imagine a complete global blackout for years. That could mean the destruction of our social order and maybe even our entire civilization. So yes, we did dodge a bullet, but don't feel too relieved just yet. Because according to physicist Pete Riley, who published a paper titled On the Probability of Occurrence of Extreme Space Weather Events, he calculated that the odds of a solar storm strong enough to disrupt our lives in the next 10 years is around 12%. Now, 12% might not seem that high to you, and it's not if you're playing a game of paper, rock, scissors, but if someone told you that you could potentially win the lottery and the chance of you winning is 12%, you'd buy a ticket right away. So yeah, looking forward to good things to come. Next up, we've been hearing for years about NASA and its grand plans of sending people to Mars and how we're all gonna live there one day and have little human Martian babies and how Earth is pretty much on its last legs and Mars is one of our only hopes for survival of mankind. But here's the thing, NASA just announced that, well, it really can't afford to send anybody there. You know, hearing this news is kind of like finding out that Floyd Mayweather can't afford to pay his taxes. So what happened? Did NASA get an entourage? Anyway, according to Associate Administrator of Human Exploration and Operations, William Gerstenmaier, I can't put a date on humans on Mars. And the reason really is at the budget levels we described, this roughly 2% increase, we don't have the surface systems available for Mars. He also said that although we don't have the money now, we could have it in the future, but also that NASA is exploring moon missions, including establishing a base on the moon. He said, if we find out there's water on the moon and we want to do more extensive operations on the moon to go explore that, we have the ability with Deep Space Gateway to support an extensive moon surface program. If we want to stay focused more towards Mars, we can keep that. So I guess living on the moon, living on Mars, same diff, right? I mean, either way, we're gonna be living in some sort of space colony and not just, you know, walking around breathing moon or Mars air. I guess the view's different. So yeah, depressing space story day, huh? We just found out we're too broke to go to Mars and a solar flare may come in the next 10 years and fry us. Yeah, I'm depressed. But let me know what you guys think of these stories. And if you had to choose between living on the moon and living on Mars, which one would you pick? Also, let me throw another what-if scenario at you guys. What if tomorrow a solar flare hits, knocks out all our power, no electricity on Earth for years? What's the first thing you would do? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'll see you later.